2,500 years ago, Zeno of Elea devised a collection of paradoxes to show that the hypothesis that the whole comes from the parts leads to absurdities, like motion is impossible. Over the millennia, many solutions to his paradoxes have been proposed, but debate continues to this day as to whether or not Zeno's paradoxes have actually been resolved. Some say that mathematicians have sorted it out. In this video, I'll present the mathematician's perspective, as well as a potential problem with it. And then we'll explore the hypothesis that the parts come from the whole, to see whether or not that view is free of absurdities. I think you'll be surprised with what we find. But first, the paradox. Let's say that Atalanta wants to walk from B to A. Before she can get all the way there, she must get halfway there. But before she can get halfway there, she must get a quarter of the way there. Before a quarter, 1/8. Before 1/8, 1/16, and so on. It's an infinite process with no first step. And since there is no first step, the trip cannot even begin. Motion is impossible. Or here's another way to put it. Let's say that Atalanta is at A and wants to get to B. She can approach B by traveling half the distance, and then traveling half the remaining distance, and half the remaining distance, and so on. It's an infinite process with no last step, and since there is no last step, she will never reach B. To solve this paradox, mathematicians begin with an assumption. We know that motion is possible, we know that Atalanta can travel from A to B, so we assume that the infinite process can be completed, such that this infinite series sums to a number. Let's call it S. Let's multiply this equation by a half, and you get half S equals a quarter, plus 1/8, plus 1/16, plus 1/32, plus 1/64, and so on. The top equation minus the bottom equation is a half S equals a half. Therefore, S equals 1. That infinite series equals exactly 1. So we made an assumption and ended up with something that seems reasonable, something consistent with a huge body of work, suggesting that that assumption is valid. Therefore, motion is possible because infinite processes can be completed. Now, let's add Thomson's lamp to the mix. Upon completing the distance associated with each term in the infinite series, a light is alternatingly turned on and off. On, then off. Then on, then off. And so on, to no end. And the question is, when the entire journey is complete, is the light on or off? It can't be on, since each moment the light is turned on, there is a later moment at which it is turned off. But it can't be off, since each moment the light is turned off, there is a later moment that it is turned on. The light doesn't converge to a final state. To express this mathematically, we can say that 0 means off and 1 means on. So we add 1 to turn the light on and subtract 1 to turn the light off. This infinite series does not converge to a value. It has no sum. But these infinite processes are executed simultaneously. So if we complete the first, we should be able to complete the second. In other words, the second infinite series should sum to a number. Let's call it L. Let's take this equation and shift all terms one term to the right. And we'll add these two equations to get 2L equals 1. L equals a half. The sum of this infinite series should be a half. But in the context of Thomson's lamp, what could a half possibly mean? When the entire journey is complete, is the light dimmed? Is it in a superposition state of on and off? Or in executing both infinite processes simultaneously, should we have concluded that neither can be completed? But if that's the case, we would need a solution to Zeno's paradox that doesn't require the completion of infinite processes. Well, consider this. To construct the history of Atalanta as she travels from A to B, we first need an equation that describes her journey. And then we can start at the first instant and march through time, one instant followed by the next. But an instant has no duration. March through a million instants and no time has passed. She hasn't moved. It is only once we have marched through uncountably infinite instants do we find that Atalanta has moved to a new position. This construction, where we build a timeline from individual points in time, is a point-based construction, and it is the construction which Zeno was attacking. How can we march through instants in time if we can't even say when the next instant is? And for any change to occur, an infinite process must be completed. But we're looking for a solution that doesn't require the completion of an infinite process. Well, there is another way to construct the history of Atalanta's journey. It is an approach very much in line with how we draw figures. When we draw a figure, we start with the big picture in mind and refine it as we go. We start with a two-dimensional space and an equation that describes her journey. But just because we have the equation, it doesn't mean that we have actually calculated her position at uncountably infinite instants. No, the equation describes her potential to be measured. And what we actually do is measure a few instants and then imprecisely connect the dots. This construction, where we start with a two-dimensional space and points in time emerge as measurements are made, is a continuum-based construction. No infinite process is completed in this construction, but motion is achieved. With this construction, there is no paradox. But what we don't have is her complete history. That would require uncountably infinite measurements to be made. It would require the completion of an infinite process. But do we even need her complete history? Do we need completeness? Well, we are certainly used to expecting it, at least in mathematics. And this has greatly influenced how we have interpreted our findings. Consider the proofs that irrationals exist, that irrationals are required for continuity, and that length comes from irrationals. With a point-based view, the fundamental objects are points. They are numbers. So it is natural to interpret these as proofs that irrational numbers exist, that irrational numbers are required for continuity, and that length comes from irrational numbers. But with a continuum-based view, the fundamental objects are continua. So it is natural to interpret these as proofs that continua exist, that continua are required for continuity, and that length comes from lines. There's a simplicity to the continuum-based interpretations. We don't have to think that a collection of zero-length points can be assembled to produce a line having length. But the continuum-based view is not free of complications. With continuum-based constructions, there are no irrational numbers. So if you ask me where these two curves intersect, I can't say the point with coordinates root 2 and 0. While I can narrow in on a range within which I am certain that they intersect, I have to concede that I am uncertain of the exact coordinates. Uncertainty is a fundamental part of continuum-based constructions. But this idea is not new. Think of how Archimedes approximated pi using polygons, concluding that it was within some given interval. Or think about continuous probability theory, where it only makes sense to talk about probabilities of ranges of outcomes. But with calculus, we try to shrink that range to a point. But given that continua are fundamental in continuum-based constructions, we can't eliminate them. So let's understand them. Let's understand what happens in between measurements. In this figure, we have measured 5 points on the blue curve. Nothing else. So it's misleading to draw the curve like this. The unmeasured curve has no definite shape. It's topological. But it is still linked with an equation. So perhaps the equation does not describe the actual shape, but instead, the average shape of the unmeasured curve. And if we insist on assigning the unmeasured curve a shape, the best we can do is to say that it's in a superposition of all possible shapes. If 300 years ago, someone told Isaac Newton that to resolve Zeno's paradox, we needed to think that the past, present, and future all exist simultaneously, that we cannot be certain of all measurements, and that definite states are not actualized until measured, I'm pretty sure he wouldn't believe it. And rightfully so. At that time, there was no scientific evidence that would justify the weird properties of continuum-based constructions. But a lot has changed in the past 100 years or so. With the theory of relativity, the concept of absolute simultaneity was eliminated, making it reasonable to think that the past, present, and future all exist simultaneously. With quantum mechanics, we now generally believe that we cannot be certain of all measurements and that definite states are not actualized until measured. Modern physics has changed our intuitions. And with modern intuitions, the continuum-based view is not so weird. In fact, its ability to vanquish long-standing paradoxes and its similarity to modern physics make it in some ways desirable. But it's new, and bad ideas often look good at first. But so can good ideas. So I think all we can conclude from this is that continuum-based constructions are worth exploring. What do you think? Let me know your thoughts in the comments, and thanks for watching.